Well, okay, so I'm starting. Today is live stream now, and we are going to talk about how to stand. Okay, so again, if you didn't watch last video where I'm talking about how to find a violin for yourself, I suggest you watch that. It's the class number one. Okay, I think this is good. Okay, so I'm very far away from the camera so that you can see most part of my body. Okay, unfortunately, I cannot make a way that you can see my feet and my head, so let's stay with this. Okay, but it's a good beginning already. Okay, so why to worry about your body posture for playing the violin? Because, as I was saying a couple of minutes ago on Twitch, I wasn't live on YouTube yet. Violin is very uncomfortable for our body. Like, we need to twist a lot of things, right? Our hands a little twisted, our necks a little twisted, and we are playing in a position that's not natural to the human body. Okay, so we want to make our body the more comfortable, the more relaxed, using the minimum force possible to do every single thing on the violin, so it will be easier and you won't hurt yourself. Okay, last thing I want for you is to hurt your body while you're practicing. Okay, and we can have really bad lesions, like hurt our bodies really badly. Okay, there is people who can't play anymore because of that. Okay, so I really hope no one's going to enter this room. But yeah, okay, so knowing your body pretty well and feeling your muscles relax, or knowing how to relax them, will be crucial, not just for the beginning of learning how to play the violin, but for the entire time that you're practicing, okay? A lot of times I'm not being able to play a passage because I'm too tense in certain parts of the body. And it's important to know that our body is not separate things, okay? I'm not like, if I'm tensing my arms, it doesn't mean that other parts of my body is also tense, okay? That's why we are going to start the body posture with our feet, okay? Because our muscles are all connected. So if your feet is tense, you're going to tense your legs, which is going to tense your back, and it's going to tense your arms too. Of course, it's a minor scale, but that is enough for like giving you a lesion and you needing to see a doctor and maybe don't be able to play or something like that. Okay, so that's the importance of posture. In addition to that, is our body who plays the violin at the end of the day. We have the meaning, the music come from our heart or whatever, you know, it's from inside you, like you have that desire of communicating what you want to say. But at the end of the day, it's the body, the arms, the fingers, right, who is going to actually make what needs to be made to the sound to come out as it needs to. So the posture is very important because of that too. Okay? Let me grab some water because I'm starting to have my mouth being dry. Okay. I really speak a lot. So, yeah. Okay, so that's the importance, okay? If you don't have a good blood pressure, you're going to hurt yourself in short or long term, okay? And you, in worst case, I mean, I don't know what's the worst case, but there is situations you need to stop playing, you see doctors, etc., things that I have to told you guys already before. Don't need to repeat, okay? So another point that's very important to say is that the body posture is not something that doesn't move, okay? It's not something that you need to stay there and you cannot move, okay? Because that's also creating more tension in the long term. So it's something like the body posture that we are going to talk now. It's something to start with, and you want to understand the concepts of the posture, okay, to apply if you want to have a step forward, or if you want to change the balance of your body from a leg to another one, or if you want to go backwards, if you want to lift the violin, okay, it's something that's movable. You can move. It's good if you move, okay, but you want to understand the concept of last effort so that you move the best way possible in a way that you're not going to make your body more stressed over the already stressful thing that is playing the violin, okay? So we will start with our feet, okay? As I told before, I'm sorry that I cannot record my feet right now, because either you're going to see my head or my feet, but I will explain to you the best way possible, okay? So the feet is already something contradictional among violin teachers, okay, because that's very common actually in Suzuki method. So if you're looking like the lower part of my feet, and those are my hands, there are people who say that your feet need to be like this, okay. I personally disagree. I would say them to be parallel to each other, okay, and I can show you a reason. But either these are a little bit open, your toes a little bit open, it's okay, okay? But the reason why I prefer your feet parallel is because the way the body works is that our knees are designed to have this motion, and our feet, if you like hold your leg like this and you let it relax, your feet are going to point to the front, to the same direction that your knee is pointing. And we are supposed to walk that way, but when we grow up, we start walking like with our feet open for some reason. But what that's actually doing is that it's twisting your leg, okay? So you're putting extra tension on your knee, okay? Now, this is not something that I read in an article or a paper written for doctors or anything like that. It's just me observing my body and thinking about it, okay? So if you disagree with it, it's okay. But don't put your feet pointing to each other, okay? This is really bad. You're going to really hurt your knee and you're going to lose balance, which is really important. And if it's too open, it's also bad for the same reasons, okay? So there is people who will say to open a little bit to gain a little bit more of balance. I like them parallel to start with, pointing to the same direction your knees are, okay? But actually, I move that a lot, okay? So I start like this. Sometimes I put one of my feet a little bit open, okay? That's something that is really common in martial arts. For example, I did karate for a couple of years. So in karate, usually you have one foot back, pointing to a side, and the other, like, pointing front, so you have a lot of balance. And of course, you're not like with the feet straight, but anyway, this is not karate classes, this is violin classes. So the point is, be with your feet either parallel or a little bit open, okay, the point, the front of your feet, but in a way that's not locking your knees, not creating more tension, okay, and you can change that as, for example, if you walk forward to like give emphasis on a passage or something like that. Okay, so that's something, and how separate your feet are is also important, okay? So if you put them really together, you're not having balance, okay? You will fall easily, and what that means is that our brain is going to be too worried about our balance. So you will be constantly thinking, I'm gonna fall. You won't think that on a level that you're aware of, but your brain will be constantly like worried about you not falling, and if anyone come and pushes you, you're going to fall really easily, and that can cause an accident and you can break your violin, something like that. So we do not want our feet together, okay? But if you have them too separate, that's too much balance. Like you're not going to fall, but you're also stuck on this position. Okay, and it ends up like being too stressful to these muscles here, right? So they're like keeping you standing, etc. So you don't have a lot of movement. So we want the middle where you are stable, but you also have flexibility. Okay, violence about this match of stability and flexibility. Okay, so the way I teach this is having both your feet under your shoulders. Okay, so they're under your shoulders, pointing to the same direction of your knees, or a little bit open. Okay, depending of your preference to let your feet, because sometimes your feet can be a little bit more open, or you know, people's body are different, so see what's comfortable for you. Okay, but make sure that you don't have any tension created there, and that your feet is under your shoulders. Okay, another good way that's really is very used with children is you to jump. And so when you come back to the floor, your feet is going to be on a good distance from each other. So if you jump, it's going to be under your shoulders. Of course, you can jump and keep them open, but you need to do extra effort to do that. Okay, so under the shoulders. Okay, pointing forward. So if you're little children, that's when you're going to put you as a parent teaching your children. Here's when you take a mat or a paper or something like that, big one, and you put on the floor and you ask the children to jump over it, and then you draw where the children need to put their feet. But as an adult, you know this and you understand where they are, so you don't need to move that much more. Okay, so that's the position of the feet. And again, it depends of your body a lot, so just keep in mind of how it feels like and know that it's okay for it to move. Okay, so next we come to our knees. Okay, the knees are a very, very key thing on our body. Actually, everything like will react to the rest of our body, but the knees are one of them that I can see really clearly. I will need to lower the camera a little bit because I really want you guys to see my knee. Then I will stop after that and lift it again so that you can see my face and won't be cut it weirdly. Okay, so give me a second please, let me lower this a little bit. Hopefully this will show my knees. I could just walk. Yeah, not really, but okay, if I stay back here, you can kind of see my head and my knees still. So my knees are here, right? I'm going to change to sideways so that you can see it dropping. Unfortunately, I'm wearing jeans. I should have put in other clothes so it would be easier for you to see, but I believe you can kind of see, you can hold the pants like this. So we don't want to not have flexibility, and we also want to stand in a way easy way. So if we make her knees too bland, okay, it's going to be very tiring. You're not going to be able to stay in this position for like 1 minute or 5 minutes for sure. So this is very bad because you're going to be tired, and again, you're using a lot of these muscles here. Okay, at the other hand, if you lock your knees behind, you're also not having flexibility, okay? And you're going to automatically lock your lower back, okay? It's automatic. If you're like this and you do this, you can feel the muscles here locking because they're holding the knee behind, okay? And like this, again, you don't have, you're not stable in a way of like someone pushing you to a side of another. You're going just to like maybe hurt your knees or something like that. So we don't want to have our knees back, neither too much to the front. Okay, so we want them on a position on the middle. And a good way of finding this is to stand, okay? Remember the position of your feet. And now you just move your both knees forward and backwards, like really quick, and see if they can move easily, okay? Here, I'm assuming that you don't have any problems with your with your legs, okay? If you do have problems with your legs, you can't stand or something like that. I'm going to talk about how to play sitting, okay, at the end. Actually, no, I can talk right now, but if you don't have, if you can stand, I suggest strongly to you to practice standing, okay, because it's very easy to lose control of the other part of your body if you're sitting down, but it will give you both options, okay? So knees on the middle, okay, so that you can move forward and backwards really easily. You can feel that your knee, both your knees are, how is solto in English? They're free to move, okay, really easily. I couldn't remember the exact translation, sorry. Yeah, but you want that really free movement, okay? So we have our feet pointing to, in my case, I'm teaching, pointing to the same direction your knees are, and under your shoulders and the knees free moving, okay? I like to call these the joke. Oh no, that just worked in Portuguese, sorry. Anyway, the key position, okay, of our knees. Then it comes, let me do it like this so that you can see better, this part of our body, okay? So this is also a key part. Actually, every part of our body is a key part, but this is going to affect directly our spine and our knees. So as I just told before, if you lock your knee back, this part of your body, wrist is this, hips, are going to go like this part is going to go to forward and you're going to throw this part backward. It's really hard to keep your knee blocked and not do that with this part. See the difference? So we don't want this and we also don't want this. And notice how my knees are related to this. Okay? So this is too much back and I'm forcing the lower back. This is too much to the front and my back is like curvy, okay, from here to here. And my knees, like my legs are going to be thyroid, okay? So you don't want to throw it to the front or to the back. You want on the middle, okay? So there is two bones on the back of, like right here, but on the back, that if you sit over your hands, you feel those two bones. So you want those two to be facing down, okay? And with your, and this come like on the middle of the movement, not to the front, not to the back, on the middle, okay? So here is when starts the difference between standing, like actually this is the difference up to this point, the difference between standing and sitting, okay? So I will go up to the body and then we'll come back and talk about sitting position, okay? But you want that to be on the middle, okay? On both situations, okay? So here at lab school, to teach like 7-year-old children, the teacher used to say like tail down. So imagine that you have a tail here, you don't want the tail up, you want the tail down, but not that down, okay? So like that. And then comes your spine. Your spine is the next part of your body posture, okay? So if you saw my post on Instagram this week, I was talking about how the spine is. So if you haven't seen it, I would highly recommend you to check that to see how is your spine, Because usually we think that the spine is something straight, but it's not. Okay, the spine has actually four curves. Okay, so the first curve is the lumbar one. Sorry, not the lumbar, the forgot the name. It's the last one here. There's two bones who do a C like this on our spine. Okay, and again, it needs to be like that, and this movement here will define how is this C here, okay? So we have this last one done by the previous step. Now the next curve, it's on the lumbar, so the lower back, and it's supposed to go the opposite way, like this. Okay, so it's a C like this, okay? And this is going to hold our balance straight. Okay, so we have four curves to make a straight line at the end of the day that stays by itself. Okay, then the next one, let me put my arm like this so you can see. So we have this one, which is the lower back one, then we have the thoracic one, which is like this. Okay, so it goes like the C is pointing forward here, okay, up to the beginning of the neck, and then we have the fourth one here, okay, that goes until behind your ear. That's the last bone of your spine. Okay, so it starts here on the cox and it ends here. Okay, that's the size of my column. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and knowing those four curves will help you to stay straight. Okay, straight is curvy for us human bodies. Okay, so if you look now that you're looking at me by the front, my column is supposed to be straight, supposed to, because there is people who has the column like this, which is not good. Okay, looking is straight. And then I don't know exactly how to help you. You should definitely see a doctor to see if you can have the option to like correct that. Okay, but if you don't have your spine curved like this, for example, your spine looking by front is straight. But if you look sideways, it's not. You have four curves, okay? So I always think of those four curves and automatically my head goes into a position that's easier to stand, okay? Because going to the head now, our head is balanced over the spine. So this last bone here that stays kind of behind our ear is where the spine gets together with our head. That's the joint part of our head and the spine, okay? So if I turn like this and I do a yes, you can see that the point that my head's moving from is right here. It's not here. It's here. You see? So this is the balance point. So you want to make sure that that's like, you know that that's the point where your spine is holding your head, and that's going to help you to don't make a lot of effort to hold your head, because your head is the heaviest part of your body. And if you're, what really happens a lot, no one stays like that. It's really rare to someone to stay like this, like pushing it backward, but it's very common to see people moving the head forward like this. What's happening here is, like, first you're changing your whole column. Okay, so it's the fourth C, the four curves are not happening anymore, especially this last one. Now it's like a straight line here, right? So this, and it's kind of easy to see because I have a really big neck, this is making all my muscles of my back need to hold my head. And my head's really, really, everyone's head's really, really heavy. So it's a lot of effort to hold the head like this, okay? Also, you can see the change of pitch of my voice when I speak like this, when I'm like here, and when I'm here. This one's the worst, but this one's not relaxed as well. Here is easy to speak because my muscles, the muscles of my neck, are really relaxed, so that I don't need to do effort to hold my head here, because my column is holding my head, you know, and that's what it was designed, or evolution made with us. Like, our head is supposed to be held by the column, okay, not your muscles. Your muscles are there to like move your head and a lot of other things. Of course, if you need to look down, they're going to hold it for a little bit, but then you need to come back to this relaxed, balanced point. Okay, so there is where you want to put your head. I'm going to sit here so that you can see that. Okay, so here. Next point is your shoulders. Okay, so your shoulder, again, if it goes too much to the back, you're forcing the column here to go like that. Okay, we don't want that. And again, my voice get tricky. If you go like too much like this, again, you're moving your spine and your head. So you want your shoulders to be on the middle of your body, okay? And that's the position of your shoulders. Now, going to the chair, if you sit, take a chair. Don't sit like this. Okay, go to the middle of the chair, kind of. And you can let your feet relax completely because they are being held by the chair, so you don't need to worry about them. The only thing you need to be worried of when you're sitting is from your ribs up, okay? So you can sit, oh god, I really want to. Something happened. My other phone. Hope it's nothing serious. Don't fall. Okay, so on YouTube you can see this clearly, but you can see it like with one leg in front of the other, like lower than the other, whatever, it doesn't really matter, as much as your ribs are correct. Okay, how to know if your ribs are correct? You're going to sit here, okay, on the chair, not on like putting your back on the chair, but without it on the chair, and you're going to put both your hands under your butt, okay, and then you're going to feel those two bones I was talking before at the beginning, okay. You want those two bones to be on the chair, so now that you know where they are, you will take your hands off and move your balance from one side to another to feel those two bones, okay? And then make sure that all your weight is over those two bones, okay? You can move like this a little bit to find those two, and okay, now you have those two bones there so that your ribs are in the correct position. And then you remember the four curves of your column, you remember your head, you remember your shoulders, and you let the rest of your hands drop. Okay, so that's the position sitting, and that's exactly the same position standing. The difference is the legs, knees, and feet. Okay, so sitting you don't need to worry about those, standing you do. Okay, so again, this is a beginning position. You can change forward or backwards, especially in orchestra. When we are playing orchestra, you want to move your body a lot, okay, but you always come back and have these as the base of your posture, okay? I will put this the cameras up a little bit again because it's cutting my head on YouTube. And yeah. Sorry about that. Thank you. Okay, so reviewing everything. If you're standing, both feet parallel to each other or a little bit opened, okay, little bit opened, okay, on the distance of your shoulders, okay, pointing to the same direction of your knees or a little bit open. Your knees need to be on a point that you can easily move them backwards and forward, okay, not locked behind, not too bent, not too bent, not too blocked, not blocked, okay, so in the middle of that, so that you can move easily. Then your ribs are on the middle of your body, so not behind, so that you're going to block your knees, not forward, that you're going to make your legs tired. If you're in the chair, feel those two bones on your butt and make sure that you're sitting over the two of them. They're holding your weight. Okay, that's why they're there. Okay, then your column have four curves. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so make sure you're aware of that and that you let your spine be on that shape. Okay, then our head is over the spine. The spine is holding your head on this position. Okay, so make sure that you're not holding your head too much to the back, neither dropping it to the front, tensioning your back. Okay, so in the middle, over your spine. And last but not least, your shoulders need to be on middle of your body, not back like this and not to the front like this, on the middle. Okay, and then your arms, on this stage of practicing, we are only going to let them loose on the side of our body. Okay, so let them fall on the side of our body, and I want you to observe the shape of your arm, like how it is when it's relaxed beside your body, and how your fingers are when you're relaxed with them beside your body. Okay, but this is the base posture. Okay, I'm with the camera too. Hi. Yeah, so this is the base posture. So you can see my hands relaxed here. They're not tense. Notice that when I'm relaxed, my hands, the fingers are a little bit round. They're not straight. Okay. The shape of it is a little round. This will be really, really important for bow hold and how to hold the violin in a little bit. Okay. So I want you to practice this posture by yourself. Okay, you can take pictures and see how natural you're standing. Keep those things in mind. And the last thing is, I know when you're tense, it's really difficult to let that tension go away, and thinking about the tension is not going to help. Okay, so a good exercise to this is find your base posture. Okay, and then with your body like this, you're going to find a place of your body that you find tense, okay, that you think is tensioned. It can be your tongue, it can be your eyes, it can be your feet, it can be your belly, it can be your back, any part, your ears, your tooth, okay, any part of your body. Then, for example, in my case, I think my left leg, the upper part of my leg is a little tense. So you're going to find now another part of your body that's relaxed compared to this first part. So in my case, my back is more relaxed than this part. Okay, so I want to pay attention, just like think of that part. And now I'm going to find another part that compared to my back is relaxed. In my case, my feet are more relaxed. And now I'm going to find another place more relaxed than my feet. My hands are more relaxed. And you're going to change the focus of your mind to those parts, and always scanning your body, trying to find something that's more relaxed than the previous one. This is a really good exercise for focus and for the posture, okay? And it's also teaching our body at the same time that you do not need to stay tense. You can relax, because this posture is a way of standing that you don't need effort, okay? Of course, if you stay too much like this, like I cannot move, then you're going to create tension, because we are built to move. So if you're too much in the same way, your body's going to get tired of that. So you need to move. So you need to change your balance from one foot to another one, etc. Okay? Posture is movement. Okay? So make sure that all those concepts are on your head. And if you want to get even better on posture, which I highly recommend, because this is the base, is like the number one important thing on violin playing, okay? I suggest you to read about Alexander technique, okay? And body language, okay? Body language is going to reinforce the idea of this open, for example, but not too much open, okay? Because our body is connected. So if we are tense mentally, we are going to be tense in our body. And the way of relaxing the anxiety on your brain is making your body more relaxed, so that you are going to transmit the idea of relaxation to your mind too. It's a very small scale. This is something that I was studying in my undergrad. Okay, it's my proposal on my paper. So it's not something that's really tested among the science society, but something that I really believe, and it's helping me a lot the past years. So I highly recommend you to read about body language too, okay? But Alexander technique for sure, okay? You're going to see how your body is connected, how it works as a unique thing and not separate things, like my left arm, my right arm, my left leg, my right leg, it's kind of things, just one thing. If your feet is tense, all your body is going to be tense because of that feet, okay? If you have any questions, I will let my, I will open a box on my Instagram, Vida.Violin, right now for questions for this, okay? And I will talk about bow hold next week. So make sure that you'll be here to learn about bow hold, okay? And keep working on the body posture every day, so that you'll be more familiar with it when we bring the violin. Okay, because the violin is something that changes everything in our body, and it's not supposed to. So it's very important to you to be very secure about your body posture, so that when we bring the violin, you will want to continue on this posture instead of changing it because of the violin, okay? And the good thing about this is that if you're doing a lecture or something like that, you can practice this, because you just need to keep thinking of your body posture. And it's going to help you with your lecture, and it's going to help you to even look more confident, because the way I'm standing shows that I'm really comfortable with this position. So it passes confidence and comfortable. It passes that I'm comfortable on this position, okay? So your audience is going to understand that too, okay? That I know for body language, by the way. And also, if you're like sitting working, you can practice sitting, maintaining this, okay? You're not going to achieve this on the first day. Just keep trying something that you get better and better and better each day, okay? But it will take you years to really get like a nice body posture, and it will change. If you sleep bad, your body posture is going to change a little. Everything influences on our body posture, and our body posture influences directly and everything, and especially on violin. So make sure that you're practicing this even without the violin, because this is already learning violin, okay? Next week, 4:30 p.m., I will be here on Monday, Mountain Daylight Time, to talk about bow hold. And the good news is that you do not need a bow to learn how to hold the bow, okay? But I will add that to the next class. And that's all. I will see you guys on the next video. Bye bye. Have a great day.